Just a few words I want to say to you about your assignment this week, looking at the Sermon on the Mount. One of the things you need to do is to ask yourself why I've put in the Sermon on the Mount. Why this particular set of scriptures from Matthew 5 through 7 are included in this notion of leadership strategies for cultural transformation. Well, the most obvious points what I'd say to you as you prepare it is obviously read the three chapters through a couple of times. And then try and get a context of where the chapters fit in Matthew's gospel. If you can, it'd be nice to actually look at the other two synoptics, Mark and Luke, to see how they fit, how Matthew fits in with the other two. What you'd find if you studied it in detail is that the Sermon on the Mount is part of what's either called Q, that is material that's found in Matthew and Luke that's not found in Mark. And Matthew has put that in a block of three chapters, not found in Mark whatsoever. The general standard was that Matthew would be the first gospel written. That was up until the 19th century. But since then, it's been recognized that Mark's most probably the first gospel that was written, and therefore Matthew and Luke expanded Mark. In fact, after the first couple of chapters in Matthew, in chapter 3 and 4, you've got Mark's material. And then in chapter 8, Matthew picks up Mark's material likewise as he follows it through. Now, Luke does the same thing, has his own source to it, but there's also this block of about 230 verses that scholars call Q, meaning quella or meaning source. We don't really know where it's come from. Some scholars want to argue that it's another gospel. If it is a gospel, it's really strange because there's no death, burial, and resurrection in it whatsoever. It could be interpreted, I don't want to go too far into this, but I do want to say it could be interpreted from the standpoint that if Matthew lose you, Luke, or Luke used Matthew, then you've got a situation whereby one copied the other. Therefore, the question is who put together the Sermon on the Mount? Because, it's, as I say, it's not found in Mark. And it's unusual because in Luke, it's not found either as a block. There are so many great sayings in the Sermon on the Mount, but it's not found in Luke. It's, in other words, it's the individual sayings in Luke are separated, a lot of them are rejected, and then the ones that he picks are put in a different order, which suggests to some scholars, that a lot of scholars actually, that there's another source, which is the Q or Quella source, from which Matthew and Luke independently actually put their material together. And at the same time, they put their own stamp, so to speak, their redactional emphasis upon the material. And this is important when it comes to the Sermon on the Mount. So from that standpoint, it's very important for you to actually put a context on the Sermon on the Mount within the context itself of those three chapters, and then in the wider context. The giveaway question I want to say to you, which it shouldn't be a giveaway question after you've read Hauwas, is the notion of to what degree and to what extent is Matthew's gospel actually a political statement that's been made? We know that's true in Luke very easily. You can see it in Luke chapter 3. In Matthew, it's perhaps less obvious, but if you are familiar with people like N.T. Wright, N.T. Wright takes the view that really what Jesus is doing in Matthew, and he follows it through with Paul too, for example, in Romans, but he argues in Matthew that Jesus is basically recapitulating, so to speak, the experience of Israel, so that Jesus functions as Israel, in a sense, in Matthew's gospel, in such statements as this was to fulfill that was said in, that's chapter 2, in terms of I brought my son out of Egypt, the quote from Hosea, which originally applied, of course, to the Israelites coming out of Egypt, being constituted as a nation, but is applied by Matthew to Jesus' parents coming back into Nazareth, and then Jesus being the one who fulfills all righteousness, an unusual statement of Jesus' baptism in Matthew chapter 3. So, in other words, then, if you look in chapter 2 of Matthew, you also notice that there's a great political struggle that goes on there, because don't think of it simply as a birth narrative in the sense of Christmas and so on. It's actually got its own very strong contextual structure that relates to the rest of the gospel. The material in chapter 2 is not found in Luke and it's not found in Mark, because there's no birth narrative in Mark anyway. Luke goes his own way with Mary and Elizabeth and so forth in respect to the first few chapters of Luke. And Matthew, of course, has the Magi going into Jerusalem, following the star, going to Herod and saying, we're going to worship the Savior who is to be born. Herod is really interested in it, and you know the reasons that Matthew gives, because basically Herod feels very threatened by it. And then the dream with the Magi after they've seen the baby, and they go back another way. And then what does Herod do? He goes into Bethlehem and he wipes out all the male children under two. In other words, then you've got the notion of a very strong political statement made at the other end of the gospel. By the other end of the gospel, I'm not talking about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, which obviously is a very great political statement that's been made in the sense of the connivance of the Jewish and Roman authorities in respect to putting Jesus to death. Well, go back to the beginning in Matthew's gospel. What do you have? You have the baby being born. The baby is such a threat that Herod tries to get rid of the baby by executing all the male children under two in Bethlehem. So straight away, as this baby is born into the world, a political statement is being made that this baby has got the power to actually change what's going on, and that the forces that be, I'm giving you Walter Wink here, the forces that be cannot deal with even the birth of this child, let alone his life and his death. So from the standpoint of the political statement that's made in chapter 2, and I sent you that sort of populistic magazine article from Sojourners by Jim Wallace on the political nature of chapter 2 in Matthew in terms of the birth narrative, you need to then read that with the Sermon on the Mount, because you know exactly, surely at this point, what I'm going to ask, what really the issue is. The issue is this the Sermon on the Mount? To what degree is it definitive for Christians today? What degree is it definitive in respect to how we are to live? For example, Hawass basically makes a statement of, all right, you can talk about Niebuhr's sort of universalistic elements in terms of the model that he picks, the transformation of society through Jesus Christ. And it reminds me of the old joke in England, being English, I can get away with this. I think that in England there are post boxes that are red, and that you put the letter within a little sort of rectangular hole in the post box. And sometimes you get so frustrated with the mailman that you want to stick the mailman in the mailbox. So you can stick him in the mailbox until you get to his feet. You can't get his feet in the mailbox. It's an old English joke. All right, but the idea is basically, if I can say that from Hawass, the notion is that ethics are universally applicable from Niebuhr. This is what Hawass is saying. Until you hit the Sermon on the Mount, that's when you hit the feet. You can't get the feet in the mailbox. He's saying the Sermon on the Mount, you can't apply it within the context of the transformation of a society. In other words, it's a mandate for the church. And as a mandate for the church, it's a mandate that's political on the basis of chapter 2, and then I'm not going into it, but the latter part of Matthew in terms of the crucifixion and so forth, and then the nature of Matthew 28, 18 through 20, where Jesus says, go into all the world, go amongst all the nations, be a political player, and establish what I've given you, teaching everyone to observe all that I've taught you. Teaching everyone to observe all that I've taught you. Take it out of its canonical sense, because usually if anybody asks you, a Christian says, well, how do you interpret that, teaching all that I've taught you and so forth? Well, you'd say the general nature of the New Testament. Take away the canonical sense and put it in Matthew. What does it mean? It means all that I've taught you in Matthew. And that must include, obviously, the Sermon on the Mount. If you've read commentaries on Matthew, you're probably aware that some scholars argue that the Sermon on the Mount, quote, is the superimposition or the fulfillment of Jesus with Moses on the Mount. This is Jesus as, you might say, the new Israel, giving his definitive notion. Because not only do we have in the material on the Sermon on the Mount the element of him digging deeper, so to speak, in respect to what the law says, he actually turns that over. For example, an eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. He turns it around and says, no, love your enemies and so on. And there's other examples of that, as well as him taking and showing further, i.e. the notion of murder and what calling someone a fool is, in other words, the intention of one's heart. All right, this point. So I'm saying, look at the context of Matthew. That's very important for the Sermon on the Mount. And then, of course, my obvious things are, check amongst your four books, check in Crouch, check in Hawass, check in, you know the stuff in Hawass anyway, check in Wink, and then check in Hunter and say, what do they have to say about the Sermon on the Mount? Because the Sermon on the Mount for Hawass is the actual sort of this is the stoppage notion of this does not work in the world. And therefore, you can't take this as an ethic and apply it in the world. Therefore, that means then that the church has got its own revolutionary ethics, as I referred to when I was summing up your statements from last week. And this is primarily, this is for the church, because it doesn't work in the world. You can't impose this in the world. And of course, the opponents of this, in other words, the opponents of, for example, Niebuhr, and you're going to find out some Calvinists who will follow this line too later on, are going to say, that's why it doesn't work, because really you can't take the Sermon on the Mount and apply it within society. So what do you do with it? Well, what you do is, you can apply it in a general way, most certainly to Christians individually, in the sense of it works on an individual basis. You are to love your enemies, but we can't use it as a political statement in the sense that countries are to love their enemies and work in the best interests of someone else, another country, as opposed to detente, etc., etc., one's security, American security in the Middle East, and so on. So it doesn't work from that standpoint. Whereas Hawass and Wink, of course, we're getting into Wink's third way, we're just about bordering onto that, are saying yes, it does, because this is the point in which the Sermon on the Mount absolutely conflicts with the world. This is the other way. This is how Christians are to live in the world, and Christians constitute the church, which is a new political entity. This is the new Israel, Matthew now, and so forth. And therefore, this is the ethic of revolution that cannot be taken into the world whatsoever. And so, therefore, and one of the element of it is, how do you interpret it? Do you interpret it from the standpoint of simply part of what I've called from Christa Stendhal's article on the notion of the introspective conscience of the West? In other words, I push that back, that line of showing how Christianity must be interpreted today. And I still feel some of you haven't really got this yet with Hawass. You're sort of interpreting him through the lens of the individualization or the privatization. Those are two words I used in respect to how our culture understands Christianity. In other words, do all this stuff by, you know, off as a church in a suburb somewhere. Whereas Hawass is arguing, and so is going to be Walter Wink, they're saying, no, the church is a political structure. And therefore, it's got its own social mores and so forth. And it's got its own ethics. And the Sermon on the Mount is the ethics of what makes the church exactly what it is. So from that standpoint, there's a lot at stake in this week in respect to understanding how we're to approach the transformation, so to speak, of culture through the strategies that we use. I'm excited by it because I love exegesis, because that's part of my own background in respect to it. To me, you've got to get the grassroots right before you start theologizing and building a systematic theology in respect to Niebuhr's five categories or whatever categories you use. So I hope that sort of gives it away in the sense of where to go this week in terms of the Sermon on the Mount as you look at it. And look at it from the standpoint of all the books that we've read, and especially the context that's in Matthew as you make your approach. Okay, thanks.